Oscar season traditionally starts next week at the Toronto Film Festival, and if history is any guide, most of this year's leading Academy Award contenders are going to open in the next 4 months. But does it have to be that way? What about the first 8 months of the year? I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Richard Roeper, columnist of the Chicago Sun-Times. On this special show, we want to look back over the year to date, spotlight some worthy movies, and give you the early line on Oscar.
Tonight was the opening of WordFest, the university's annual three-day gap-a-thon for writers and wannabes. My editor, Terry Crabtree, was flying in for the event. He alone had championed my last novel.
Michael Douglas is outstanding as a complex and rumpled college professor in Curtis Hanson's Wonder Boys, a movie that's every bit as entertaining as Terms of Endearment or Rain Man. The difference being that those Oscar-winning films were big hits while Wonder Boys was dropped into theaters in late February and was gone before the first hint of spring. Now, Paramount is bringing Wonder Boys back to theaters in October during the first lap of what has become known as Oscar season. The studio is undoubtedly hoping for the boost many potential nominees have gotten from opening later in the year. For example, of the last 15 Best Picture winners, only 4 opened before September. The rest were late-year releases, including 6 Best Picture victors that didn't arrive until December.
I think Paramount's decision to give Wonder Boys another chance is a really good one. The film has the kind of special qualities that Academy voters are looking for. It focuses on the creative process, it has humor based on human nature, and it's more about the characters than about the plot. I hope it gets the nominations the studio is hoping for, and on this show, we want to go ahead and mention some other work that deserves Academy recognition. Tops on my list from earlier in the year is High Fidelity, a lovable and very smart film about guys who work in a used record store and the girls who try and try to understand them. It stars John Cusack, who in this scene has just broken up with his girlfriend, played by Eben Yale.
My desert island. All time, top 5 most memorable breakups in chronological order are as follows. Allison Ashmore, Penny Hardwick, Jackie Alden, Charlie Nicholson, and Sarah Kendrew. Those were the ones that really hurt.
And here's Cusack's real-life sister, Joan, playing the ex-girlfriend's best friend.
You, before you started all this psychotic madness, there was no unit. There was just 3 people in a mess. But now, they've got something in common. And you don't want to make anything worse.
How could it get any worse than Laura with Ian?
Most characters in the movies don't work at real jobs, but John Cusack does in this film. And it defines him. He rummages through old records for the moments that are pure and true, and he rummages through his romantic memories in the same way. His problem is he keeps all of his old records and he ditches all of his girls. High Fidelity is definitely one of the best movies of the year.
I agree with you on this. John Cusack was in a movie called Say Anything, and 10, 15 years later, people are still referencing that movie and watching it on video, and I think the same thing's going to happen with High Fidelity. People already are talking about this. The people who did see this movie and sought it out really like it a lot, and they should because it's that good.
You know, this is one of those movies where people come up to you on the street and they say, did you see High Fidelity?
Yeah,
I mean,
it's
people pass the movie around. I'm sure it's going to become a classic on video because it's one of those word-of-mouth films where people say it's really special to me and I want you to see it.
Well, I hope it does become that. But it's more than just a cult movie. It's a really good, solid piece of filmmaking. So I agree with your vote for High Fidelity. Now, for me, perhaps the most powerful and moving film I've seen this year is Sunshine, a 3-hour epic about a family of Hungarian Jews battling oppression on various fronts and over a period stretching from the late 19th century through the rise and fall of the Third Reich and into the early years of the Cold War. Ralph Fiennes plays 3 characters, grandfather, father, and son, but this isn't a special effects gimmick in which he interacts with himself.
Then I have to please our family and the memory of our rabbi grandfather and his blessed Torah. There's the emperor, liberal spirit, Roman law. I have to please the government and its opposition. What about my own sense of justice? I have to please our brother, who wants to turn the world upside down, and our father, who wants to keep the world exactly as it is.
Fine slips into each character as a young man, aging in each role, and he does it beautifully.
You see, when I want to win, I win.
Win what? Who are you planning to defeat?
Your fiancé.
Not only does Sunshine deserve Best Picture consideration, Fiennes has to be a front-runner for Best Actor as he carries this rich, surprising, and beautiful story on his shoulders and never misses a step. With its epic length and serious tone, Sunshine isn't exactly a summer date film, but it does incorporate many Oscar-worthy characteristics. The strong story, the large and talented cast, the romance, the heartbreak, the tension. It's a movie for grown-ups.
Yes, it is, and Fiennes does a great job here of playing each of these three guys at about the same age and letting them age. So it's not a stunt. It's really an interpretive acting.
You know how you meet a son sometimes who's a lot like the father but has a little... That's what he does with each of these three characters.
You got it. Coming up next, a look at contenders for Best Actress.
Corporate is claiming they had no way of knowing what was going on in Hinckley.
Oh, they knew. They had to know.
Who showed them the document that proves it?
At this point in time, Julia Roberts' Erin Brockovich is the clear frontrunner for Best Actress, and it's been reported that Universal is going to make sure we don't forget that by re-releasing the movie in theaters later this year. But it would be a shame if the Academy failed to remember another big star come nomination time, Demi Moore in Passion of Mind, a box office dud that got squeezed by all the big, loud summer releases.
It's even worse than you think.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah, I'm not interested in dating you.
You're not.
Moore plays a glamorous, high-powered, and single literary agent in New York who lives a second life in her dreams as a widowed young mother in France. Or is it the other way around?
You're analyzing yourself. You're courting yourself. You're making love to yourself.
Sorry. Now, Demi Moore has given some bad performances in some awful movies, such as Striptease and Indecent Proposal, and oh my goodness, The Scarlet Letter. But in Passion of Mind, she's more mature, more nuanced, and lovelier than she's ever been. I think it's the best acting job of her career.
You know, Godard said that the best way to criticize a movie is to make another movie, and I think I have another movie to kind of respond to, because Demi Moore is an actress who can be very, very good, but I think that there was another performance this year in a similar theme that is even better. And the one I'd like to see nominated is Rachel Griffiths for Me, Myself, I. Coincidentally, like your choice, this is also a movie about a woman who moves between lifestyles, between being an independent single woman and suddenly finding herself with kids in her life. I think Me, Myself, I is the better film, and Griffiths has struck me for a long time as one of the most underappreciated actresses around. Playing a single woman, look at the play of emotions on her face here as she looks through old photographs and wonders if she took the wrong turn in life.
Oh, Robert Dixon. Why did I let you go?
Then through magical means, she finds herself married to one of those old boyfriends and the mother of their children. Even they don't know her secret. And look at the way her eyes reveal her thoughts in this family scene in a restaurant.
I know you're going to think this is a little corny, but, I was wondering if we...
Dad, you're supposed to get on me.
Oh, hell. How about taking out an option on another 13 years?
If Rachel Griffiths specializes in anything, it's projecting intelligence. She likes to play characters who think, who size up situations, who act out of a pretty good knowledge of themselves. Me, Myself, I is a fantasy, of course, but it's one grounded in reality. The Rachel Griffiths character realizes that for the kids, this magical transfer of lifetimes is not about her at all. She's just their mom.
Well, I agree with you about Rachel Griffiths. She's very good in this, although I disagree. I still think Passion of Mind does a better job of dealing with the dual switches going on with the two lives. They're both fantasies, of course, but it's great to see a character actress like this in a leading role, and she is wonderful in it.
She's very good, and you know, what's neat is it all happens really. I mean, the thing about Passion of Mind is there's an extra element or additional level of gimmick that I think is kind of distracting. We're constantly wondering how the jet lag works or the time difference as they go back and forth between New York and France. Here, I think the movie is much more direct in showing us these two lifestyle
Which
choices.
May be more implausible, though.
Well, I think they're both pretty implausible. Okay, coming up next, the race for Best Actor, he saw.
Nobody teaches a writer anything. You tell them what you know. You tell them to find their voice and stay with it. You tell the ones that have it to keep at it. You tell the ones that don't have it to keep at it, too, because that's the only way they're going to get where they're going.
In the Best Actor category, two of the leading contenders, in my mind anyway, are Michael Douglas for Wonder Boys and John Cusack for High Fidelity. But I hope the Academy also considers a lower-profile film that contains extraordinary acting. And I'm thinking of Jesus' Son, starring Billy Crudup, as a drifter with no particular connection to life. This is the hardest kind of role to play. There's no plot to drag him along, and he isn't a real take-charge guy in the movie. To be passive and still to be interesting, that's a challenge for an actor.
I don't have a job.
No kidding.
I smoke cigarettes.
And you taunt nonstop.
No, I don't. No, usually I don't. Except when I'm nervous.
Billy Crudup played a congressional candidate in Waking the Dead, and he's been in movies by Woody Allen and Stephen Frears. He's always good, but he's not a showboat. He doesn't go for flash. He becomes absorbed by a role. And in Jesus' Son, although he passes through the hell of drug addiction, he always lets us know he's got a good heart. A role like this is eminently harder to play than a high-voltage showcase role, and I think it's best actor material.
Well, I didn't like this movie when it came out. I know you did. And I think he does kind of overdo it in some of the scenes, and he overplays it. But it's an interesting performance, and the guy's obviously got a world of talent. I'll be okay with it if they don't find this guy on the time when they do the entire list of nominees, if they don't go with
him. Yeah, well, I know he's probably an underdog, but on the other hand, when we see so much junk week after week, to see a really special movie like this is a treat.
Yeah, and here's another one that people didn't see that much, and my choice in the Best Actor category would be Christian Bale in American Psycho, the adaptation of the Bret Easton Ellis book that created a ton of advance controversy but was met with audience indifference when it was released in April. Now, I'm still not sure how much of a satire this is, but Bale has a great time sinking his teeth into the role of a cheerfully insane serial killer slashing his way through the money-hungry Manhattan of the mid-80s.
He's been compared to Elvis Costello, but I think Huey has a far more bitter, cynical sense of humor.
Hey, Albert.
Yes, Alan?
Why are there copies of the style of sex all over the place? Do you have a dog? A little chow or something?
No, Helen.
Is that a raincoat?
Yes, it is.
Not since Anthony Hopkins in Silence of the Lambs have we seen such a weirdly charismatic psycho killer. The preposterously handsome Bale goes all out in the risk-taking showcase role he's got here, and the result is somehow funny, chilling, and mesmerizing.
Yeah, I agree with you up to a point. You know, Mary Harron, who directed this movie, brought a woman's point of view to the story of a male sexual predator. And oddly enough, having seen the film and thought about it, it's as much about materialism as it is about sex.
Oh, absolutely.
It's about this guy using all of the world as a consumer, and he's just going to... It's just all for him.
He gets more turned on when he touches his business card than when he's looking at any of these women.
That's his
big
thrill.
It's an interesting, interesting choice. Okay, for supporting actress, my pick is Diane Lane, who brings strength and dignity to a traditional girlfriend part in The Perfect Storm. While she's still the most beautiful woman you're going to find in any fisherman's tavern in America, she does convey a sense of someone who has worked long hours for many years while enduring multiple hardships and putting up with men who rarely come through in the clutch.
You're counting your money. And my guy's out there, risking his life for a bunch of stupid fish.
That's the game.
I hate the game. I hate the damn game. Do you hear me? Do you read me?
Diane Lane is the primary force that lifts The Perfect Storm above the level of a mainstream summer thrill ride, giving it real depth and humanity and giving it real chances to nab nominations, not only for Lane's acting and for the special effects, but I think also for Best Picture.
Well, I think it has a real good chance of being nominated for Best Picture. And, you know, Lane's role is kind of thankless, you know.
Sure.
In a movie like this, it's like the astronauts' wives who are down on the ground when they're in trouble in space.
Exactly.
Or any movie like that where somebody has to just sit there and react. It's kind of like Cheers, Get Serious. And she does
a real good job.
You know? Yeah, she brings nuance to this.
Yeah.
Okay, someone I think the Academy should keep in mind for Best Supporting Actress is Tracy Ullman in Woody Allen's Small Time Crooks. She's known as a comedian, of course, but she has an enormous acting range. And in this movie, she drives the transitions between the three acts. In the beginning, she's a long-suffering wife of a loser nebbish, played by Alan. Notice how she's sort of clueless at this point.
How are you going to make us rich? Rob a bank?
How'd you know that? That's fantastic. How'd you guess that?
What?
A little later in the movie, she becomes a millionaire, selling the cookies she baked as a cover for the bank heist. And then... she recruits Hugh Grant to coach her at social climbing, and look at the manic zeal for self-improvement that she has here.
What did you think of her plan?
Oh, well, I just got to tell you, I thought the whole evening was apocalyptic.
Apocalyptic,
yes,
really?
Totally. I mean, I really was agog.
Well, me too. I mean, she's fabulous.
She's fabulous, and I have to asseverate she deserves accolades.
Small-Time Crooks is Woody Allen's biggest success in years, and Tracy Ullman, I think, had a lot to do with that. She's the anchor to the story. Every time the story threatens to bog down, she goes through another transformation, and the movie is renewed. And she's on my list of possible supporting actress nominees.
You're right about Tracy Ullman. You think of her as, like a TV comedian, like the Carol Burnett of her generation. But she's more talented than just a comedian. And if anybody can get a performance that might get a nomination, it would be Woody Allen. He's done it before. I think of Mira Sorvino in Mighty Aphrodite. So maybe Tracy Ullman will get her shot here.
Oh, yeah. He gets a lot of nominations for people without ever getting very
many. And they never get another one.
Yeah. Coming up next, two veteran performers vie for Best Supporting Actor.
Last year, the supporting actor category was the one with all the heat. You had Tom Cruise in Magnolia, Haley Joel Osment in The Sixth Sense. You had Jude Law in The Talented Mr. Ripley, Michael Clark Duncan in The Green Mile, and the winner, Michael Caine, in The Cider House Rules. And we're already seeing some standout entries this year, led by the underappreciated Bill Murray as Polonius in Hamlet.
Rich, not gaudy, for the apparel of proclaimed the man. Neither a borrower nor a lender be, for loan oft loses both itself and friend.
The amazing thing about Murray here is that even though he's one of the great comics of our time, we have no trouble accepting him reciting Shakespeare, albeit as a character who has some pretty funny lines. Now, this is not the first time Murray has given an Academy Award-level performance. You could argue his case for Groundhog Day and certainly for Rushmore, but this is probably his best chance yet for a nomination.
You know, I love Murray, and one of the things I like about him is his kind of sideline in dropping into movies with a perfect little cameo role. He did it in Tootsie. He did it in, to a larger extent, in Rushmore. Here he is again here, bringing the movie to life and then kind of disappearing again in this case.
And every time you see him,
behind the curtains, yeah. For Best Supporting Actor, I hope the Academy takes a close look at Danny DeVito's work in The Big Kahuna. This was a movie with a small cast, and it mostly took place in one room at a trade show, but it needed that sense of claustrophobia for its long night's journey into self-revelation. Kevin Spacey and DeVito are two veteran salesmen, and in this scene, DeVito shows what a wonderful verbal actor he is, making it come straight from the heart.
I don't know why, but I've always had this haunting feeling that I had some kind of mission here on Earth.
A mission?
Yeah.
The Big Kahuna ends with a long speech by Danny DeVito that sums up everything in the movie. And long speeches can be death in the movies, but not this one, where DeVito analyzes what we've seen, he finds the message, he draws conclusions for his own life. He's able to make what he says seem very important, even urgent, at least at that moment, at least to him. He deserves consideration, I think, for Best Supporting Actor for The Big Kahuna.
Yeah, I didn't like the movie as much as you did, but I did like Danny DeVito, and I think he's another character actor who doesn't get enough credit. We know his persona so well, but you're right. You just go this much on his face, and you realize how talented he really is.
You know, it's a funny thing. Whenever I see DeVito on the screen, I kind of brighten up because he has a kind of energy that's going to carry over whatever role he's in and make it interesting.
And there's nobody else like Danny DeVito, and we like that.
That's right.
Okay, coming up next, we name our Dark Horse favorites that we hope will get Oscar consideration.
Now let's really go out on a limb and select a couple of personal favorites that are long shots, movies with Oscar chances that range from slim to none. My long shot choice for Best Director would be Sofia Coppola for The Virgin Suicide, telling the story of five sisters who mesmerized all the guys in the neighborhood with their mysterious, elusive, and unattainable charm. At the end of the film, there are no easy answers, only a feeling of loss and the question of whether we ever really know who anybody else really is. The Virgin Suicide, great directing by Sofia Coppola.
My underdog is Michael Almereyda's Hamlet. Not exactly an unfamiliar title or story, but it's a completely fresh version. Set in modern-day New York and framed as a corporate power struggle, the movie stars the age-appropriate Ethan Hawke in the title role.
To die. To sleep. A chance to dream.
for in that sleep of death what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause.
I've already mentioned Bill Murray's Polonius, but I also think best supporting nods could go to Kyle MacLachlan as the scheming Claudius, Diane Venora as the duplicitous Gertrude, and Julia Stiles as the ever-tragic Ophelia. Hamlet has a striking visual style, some clever innovations, and oh yeah, a pretty good original script to work from. And for once, Hamlet isn't played by some 45-year-old.
Well, I think you're a real optimist if you think Hamlet's going to get 5 nominations, including Best Picture.
I said they could go to these people.
Yeah, well,
okay.
These are our personal long shots, and that one's really pretty long.
It's a good movie.
I hope that the Academy does go back over the first 8 months of the year and look at some of these pictures or some of the other pictures and not just make it the Academy Awards for the last 4 months of the year, which is kind of what it's settling
down to be.
That's
right. The Oscar season is only unofficial. The other movies do qualify.
You got it. Okay, that's it for this special show. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of some of the new fall movies, including The Watcher, a psycho thriller starring Keanu Reeves and James Spader, and also Nurse Betty. That's next week. And until then, the balcony is closed.